Good morning. It's good to be with you here for another Sunday together while we are apart. But we do share this time together in spirit, and so we feel that togetherness while we are in our homes and while I am here in this place. But we do look forward to that time that we will be back together again. And I have good news for you this morning. Our reopening task force has been hard at work coming up with a plan. They've come up with a plan that session has approved, and barring anything happening between now and then that would change these plans, we have a plan to be back together again for worship. It will be different. It won't be our normal Sunday morning for a little while yet, because there's just too much that will keep that from being a safe option for us and for so many of the more vulnerable members of our church family. But we will be together. So here's the plan, and we'll keep you updated on it as we get closer to it to make sure that all of this is in place and to give you more details. But basically, here's what it is. We will be worshiping beginning Saturday, July 11th at 6:30 in the evening outside in the parking lot behind the Learning Center. We will have all the elements that we normally have in worship, because outside we can sing when inside we may not be able to. We'll have worship together. We will share communion together. We will pray. We will sing. We will share in God's word, and we will be together. We'll spread ourselves out. We'll wear our masks. We will be safe in all that we do, but we will be together. And so I am so excited about it. So stay tuned for more information about that as we get closer to that date. But for now, we join together this way, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, we are held together, and we are together, even though we are apart. So now let us come into the presence of the living God, and let us worship Him together.
The Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Out of His fullness we have all received grace in place of grace already given. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ.
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, He amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not His equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is He, Lord Sabaoth, His name, from age to age the same. And He must win the battle. This world with devils filled should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God has willed His truth to triumph through us. Prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fail him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The Spirit and the gifts are ours, through him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also, the body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever.
This Bible verse is from Colossians 3:12-17. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other, just as the Lord has forgiven you. So you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourself with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which you, indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. And with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen.
So over this spring and this summer, we've been looking at the faith of Fred Rogers and how it can inform us and encourage us in our own faith, especially in these unique and unsettling and uncertain times that we are in at this time. And as we've been doing so, we've been reminded of the kindness and the peacefulness and the hopefulness in this environment that Fred created through his program, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, for children and for people of all ages. And we've learned that he created this program, this neighborhood, because he saw so much meanness and so much violence in the world. And he wanted to give children and he wanted to give their families a different vision about how life can be and about how people can be. It was a vision that was informed for Fred by the vision that Christ gave us in his teachings, in his life, and in his work, a vision of the kingdom of heaven, of God's kingdom, of peace and hope and light and love. And Fred's faith gave him this longing for this peace and this light and this hope and this love, then to be known on earth as it is in heaven. This was Fred's prayer. This was his work. And because Fred had such a special tenderness, as we've talked about in these past weeks, for the needs of the neighbor and to care for the least of these, Fred was especially sensitive to all the ways that people do not experience that peace and hope and light and love, to all the ways that anger and hatred and darkness and evil are present, and the pain that they bring to our world. Well, Fred told of a time when he was visiting his beloved teacher, William Orr, in the nursing home where Orr spent the last years of his life. Fred and his wife Joanne would go to visit with him each week on Sundays, and they would join him for the service there at the nursing home. Well, on this one particular week in the service, they had sung the great hymn, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, written by that great reformer, Martin Luther. Well, Fred remembers this. He said, I wanted so much to ask Dr. Orr this question. I said, Dr. Orr, you know, in that verse, it says something about the Prince of Darkness grim, we tremble not for him. And then it goes on, and it says at the very end of the verse, one little word can fell him. I said, Dr. Orr, what is that one little word that can wipe out the Prince of Darkness, that can fell him? He thought for a moment, and he said, forgiveness. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He said, Fred, there is one thing that evil cannot stand. That is forgiveness. Evil simply disintegrates in the presence of forgiveness. When you look with accusing eyes at your neighbor, that is what evil would want, because the more the accuser can spread the accusing spirit, the greater evil spreads. On the other hand, if you can look with the eyes of the advocate on your neighbor, those are the eyes of Jesus. You see, evil's hope is that when we have been wronged by another for any reason or to any degree, that we will feel deeply that anger and that hurt that comes from that, and that we will let that anger and that hurt drive us and shape our response. Evil is betting on us, seeing ourselves as victimized and our hurt as prioritized and our being as canonized, to the point that we look at the one who has hurt us and we see an object rather than a person. We see an enemy rather than a neighbor. And our hurt turns to hate. And then our hate leads us to lash out. And then our goal becomes revenge. And any means to reach that goal is justified by its end and by its beginning. Or as Martin Luther King Jr. explained it in 1963, hate multiplies hate. Violence multiplies violence. And toughness multiplies toughness in a descending spiral of destruction. In this descending spiral of destruction that the Prince of Darkness, that evil and sin strives to create and nurture in our world, in our lives. But that is not God's plan for us, and that is not God's desire for his world. And we, as his people, his light in this world, the hands and feet of his Son on earth, of the Prince of Peace, we are not called to create and nurture that destruction. Rather, we are called to create and to nurture the love and the grace and the mercy and the light and the hope and the peace of the kingdom of God here on earth. The one thing that stops that descending spiral in its path, the one thing that the Prince of Darkness fears, the one thing that will fell him then, is, as Dr. Orr told Fred, the forgiveness that denies that destruction. Forgiveness, though, as we all know, can be hard, because there are real and raw emotions involved. Anger and frustration and hurt and grief. One thing that Fred addressed often with children in his program was the validity of feelings and emotions, that when something sad happened to them, that it was okay for them to be sad. And that when something frightening happened, that it was okay to feel afraid. And when something mean or unkind happened, that it was okay for them to be mad. But Mr. Rogers would teach the children in so many ways and about so many different feelings, that what matters is what we do with those feelings. In the 26th season of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, several episodes address the reality of why we feel mad sometimes and what we do about it. In an ongoing storyline throughout these episodes, one of the neighbors in the neighborhood of make-believe, Lady Elaine Fairchild, had taken up drawing. And she was trying to draw a picture of Grand Père's tower, but she could not draw it to her satisfaction. She became frustrated, and then she got angry at her failure at first. And then that anger grew to make her mad at everyone and everything. And she started to do things out of her anger, like turning Grand Père's tower upside down by the magic of her boomerang, tumerang, sumerang. and turning a neighbor into a doll. Her anger and the things that she did out of anger were frightening to the others in the neighborhood, and they all lived in fear of what she might do next. Well, finally, a few wise friends got together, and they helped Lady Elaine, helped her to find a more productive way to release all those negative feelings that she had built up inside of her, like making clay and pounding on it, or hammering on a pounding board. And only as she was able to find these ways of expressing her pain without causing pain to others could peace then return to her spirit and to the neighborhood. Well, this storyline came out of Fred's studies and his work in child development, and out of a psychological concept that is known as sublimation. Basically, what sublimation is it means channeling behaviors that are not socially acceptable into more appropriate and acceptable behaviors. This concept recognizes the validity of emotions that one may experience, but it diverts their expression into ways that don't cause pain and suffering for others. There are times that someone upsets us, Fred would teach. And in those times, we will feel angry, and we will feel hurt, and we will feel frustrated. But in those times, we should not let our feelings make us do things that hurt other people or hurt people back. He wrote a song, as he often did, to help children learn this and to understand this. It's simply titled, "What Do You Do With the Mad That You Feel?" What do you do with the mad that you feel, the song asks. When you feel so mad you could bite. When the whole wide world seems oh so wrong and nothing you do seems very right. What do you do? Do you punch a bag? Do you pound some clay or some dough? Do you round up friends for a game of tag? Or see how fast you can go? It's great to be able to stop when you've planned a thing that's wrong and be able to do something else instead. And maybe sing this song. You see, when theologians talk about forgiveness, they'll talk about this very concept, but they'll use terminology that makes it seem so much more complicated. But it is, as Fred taught generations of children, not that complicated. The first step of forgiveness is this release. Evil tries to tell us that when we have been hurt, that somebody else needs to hurt too. And it will bubble up and it will brew in us until hurt becomes hate that bursts out in acts of aggression and anger, not just against the one that hurt us, but in ways that hurt everyone around us. Evil seeks to let our anger and our hurt boil and bubble until it erupts and starts us on that destructive cycle that leads to destruction that Martin Luther King Jr. described. It's so easy to pick up a gun and shoot somebody, Fred once explained, but it's so much healthier and so much more dramatic to work out something interpersonally with somebody and come to a resolution that mends injury in both people's lives. When we can take this first step of forgiveness by releasing the feelings of anger or hurt in non-harmful ways, then we are able to begin to deny that destruction that evil seeks to create by refusing to pour more pain and more suffering and more anger and more hatred and more violence out into the world because of our own anger or pain. And by refusing to allow it to build up inside of us. You see, when we allow that anger or that pain to build up inside of us, it creates this wall of resistance in us. And that wall will keep us from being able to experience the joy and the peace and the freedom that God longs for us to know in Him and in the forgiveness and the grace that we have been given from Him. And that wall keeps us then from being able to see others as our neighbor, but only as our enemy, and not as a person, but only as the object of our wrath. But when we have released our anger or our pain in non-harmful ways, we don't let that wall build up. And then we are freed. We're freed to see with clarity and with joy the incredible grace and love that we have received from God, and we can feel honest and humble gratitude for it. And when we have released our anger or our pain in non-harmful ways, we are freed then to see the other, even that person who caused us such pain, not as the object of our anger or of our revenge, but to see them as God's beloved, as those who are created in God's image, to see them through eyes of love and not eyes of anger, to see them as neighbor and not as enemy. We are freed to desire then for the other, not what we think we need in order to feel justified or avenged, but rather to desire for the other what God desires for them, life and love and hope and grace and wholeness and peace. And to recognize that what God has done for us to give us that life and that wholeness and that peace, He has done for them too. That the grace that He has extended to us, He extends to them too. And since we have received that grace, the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Colossae, then we are to extend that grace to them, even if they have brought pain to us. To release them into God's hands of justice and grace. And to pray for God's work in them as He continues to work in us. And to put on that compassion and kindness and humility and gentleness that we are given in Christ. And to let our lives shine with them. And to rest in God's peace. This is what forgiveness is. It's forgiveness that welcomes, as Jesus taught the wayward child. It is forgiveness that erases, as Jesus taught, the debt that is owed to us by another. It is forgiveness, as Jesus taught, that calls my enemy my neighbor and my friend. It is forgiveness that extends grace and love even at the point of love, at the point of death, as Jesus did, to the ones who caused the greatest pain and the greatest suffering. And when we learn to forgive this way, it can transform us. It can transform relationships. It can change the world. So earlier I shared with you part of a quote from Martin Luther King Jr. Here I want to share it with you in its fullness. "Darkness cannot drive out darkness," King said. "Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Hate multiplies hate, violence multiplies violence, and toughness multiplies toughness in a descending spiral of destruction. The chain reaction of evil, hate begetting hate, wars producing more wars, must be broken, or we shall be plunged into the dark abyss of annihilation." The Prince of Darkness, grim, the hymn goes, "We tremble not for him, for one little word can fell him." What is that word? It is forgiveness. For when forgiveness refuses to cause more pain or suffering in the world because of the anger or the hurt that we feel in our own suffering, hate is not allowed to beget more hate, and violence is kept from producing more violence. When forgiveness frees us to see one another through God's eyes of love and release one another into God's hands of grace, the chain reaction of evil is broken and the descending spiral of destruction is destroyed. Friends, these are difficult and unsettling and uncertain times. These are times that too easily can lead us to build up those walls of anger and hurt and hate inside of us. In Mr. Rogers' neighborhood, Fred shared with us his vision. He shared with us God's vision of how life can be and of how people can be. It was a vision informed by the vision that Christ gave us in his life and in his teaching, a vision of the kingdom of heaven, of God's kingdom, a kingdom of peace and hope and life and love, his kingdom of grace, his kingdom of forgiveness. So then, as we walk through this unsettling time, may we find encouragement from Fred's faith in these times, the encouragement that he found in Scripture, to love as we have been loved, and to forgive as we have been forgiven, so that God's kingdom will be known on earth as it is in heaven, in this time and in all times. Amen.
Sometimes people are good, and they do just what they should. But the very same people who are good sometimes are the very same people who are bad sometimes. It's funny, but it's true. It's the same, isn't it, for me? And sometimes people get wet, and their parents get upset. But the very same people who are wet sometimes are the very same people who are dry sometimes. It's funny, but it's true. It's the same, isn't it, for me? And sometimes people make noise, and they break each other's toys. But the very same people who are noisy sometimes are the very same people who are quiet sometimes. It's funny, but it's true. It's the same, isn't it, for me? And sometimes people get mad, and they feel like being bad. But the very same people who are mad sometimes are the very same people who are glad sometimes. It's funny, but it's true. It's the same, isn't it, for me? And sometimes people are good, and they do just what they should. But the very same people who are good sometimes are the very same people who are bad sometimes. It's funny, but it's true. It's the same, isn't it, for me? Isn't it the same for you?
Friends, we have heard the Word of God. The Word of God helps us. The Word of God instructs us. The Word of God comforts us. But we come unto God now in the bond and spirit of prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we come to you this day, not knowing what each one needs, not knowing what is on your mind. But keep this in mind: God knows all things, and we come unto God asking that those things be given unto us. If we need help, reach out to us. If we are sick, heal us. If we are in need of understanding, bring someone to us who can give us that understanding. We ask now that you be with those that are confined to their homes, those that are in hospitals, those that are in nursing homes, those who need your help each and every day. And as we think about them, we think about those who are caring for them, people that are often forgotten, nurses, nursing assistants, the people that bring the food to the bedside. We give you thanks for the way that we are cared for in our time of need. If we have a problem now, turn it around. Make it not a problem, but make it a joy. Grant us unto you our everlasting peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secure.
Friends, it has been good to be with you in this time, but now we go on to whatever the rest of our weeks may hold for us. It will be different for each one of us, and yet it will be the same, for we each go held in God's hands. So as you go from this time, as you go to whatever life holds for you in these coming days, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May He lift up His countenance upon you, and may He give you peace this day and forevermore. Amen.